Thank you for being here today. It's great to have you. This is the sort of the fourth Sunday of Advent in the morning, and then tonight it's Christmas Eve because it's the 24th. I am grateful that you are here. Going to church at Christmas time is not a popular thing to do anymore, in spite of the fact that it's called the Christ Mass. Was one of the highest celebrations of the year. But you're here today, and that's all that counts. That's really, really important. So thank you for being here. Today we're going to be lighting the fourth Advent candle, the candle of love. And we're also having a traditional service called a Feast of Nine Lessons in Carols. It's all in the bulletin here. If this is your first time, you can follow through in the bulletin. The nine lessons in carols started in about 1880, and it's traditionally recorded as having been first service in the Truro Cathedral in Cornwall. Now, what used to happen was carols were often just sung by the singers in people's houses. That's how it started. And they were considered secular in the old days, in the 19th century. They were considered secular. They were just tunes that people sang. And they had been excluded from Christian worship up until that time. Well, in 1878, the organist John Stainer introduced carols into the choral evensong at church. Now, just imagine singing pub songs at church. It freaked people out. But, of course, they included the Christian lyrics. And then eventually, in the Truro Cathedral, they sang carols at the 10 o'clock morning service. That totally freaked people out. It's hard for us to believe that. But just 100 years ago, carols were never sung in the church. And then eventually, the late Dr. Benson, he was the Bishop of Truro, decided that he was going to put carols and lessons together. And the 24th of December in 1880, they had their first ever nine lessons in carols. The reason why the bishop made a service of carols and lessons, he was so concerned in Cornwall, so many people went to the pubs. There were so many people drinking, and the consumption of alcohol was so high in Cornwall, he thought he might bring the pub songs into the church. And so the tunes, many of the tunes we sing, are old English pub songs with Christian lyrics, hoping to offer a witness to all the people in the community who never even thought about going to church on a Sunday. So the first lesson, 10 a.m., Sunday the 24th in 1880, and 400 people attended church. Most of them were drunks. So now, I'm not saying anything about you today, but that's why we're doing this. And for 100 years, we've been telling the story of the lesson and the carol, the lesson and the carol. So I pray that you would be inspired and encouraged by the story today. The way it works is I'm going to get you to stay seated for everything other than the last gospel reading, which is the ninth lesson. So during the service, just stay seated for everything so that there's a flow, and you'll see it'll just happen by itself. Now, having said that, are you ready for church?
Yes.
Good. Okay, remain seated, and you follow through along in your program.
Jesus.
fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Tessa, you brought your hubby along. Would you like to introduce him to us?
Yes, my husband Bashir.
Bashir, and originally from Ottawa, now living in Frankfurt.
Düsseldorf.
Yeah. And Sweden before that. So international family. Let's welcome Bashir, everybody. And it's great to have Tess and Jacob back again. Now, going back this way, regulars, we know, and going down this way. Let's have a look. Now, we've got a young man from South Surrey named Jerry who's visiting with us today. So can we welcome Jerry? Good to meet you, Jerry.
Jerry is also in our Christian writing group.
Oh, in the Christian writing group. Great. So hands up if your name is Jerry today. We have two Jerrys, see? First and second Jerry. So there you go, two Jerrys. And going back down here, now we have another family sitting back there. Would you like to introduce yourselves to us? Tell us your first name and where you're from. Yes, please.
My name is Azim Ibrahim Zadeh, and origin of Iran.
Iran?
Left Iran 48 years ago.
And where do you live now?
But living in Crescent community.
In Crescent community. And your first...
We moved actually from Burnaby. I've been living in Burnaby for my wife and I, Isusa, myself, and my brother-in-law and his wife. They just arrived from Philippines, visiting us here.
From the Philippines?
Yes.
Wow. So your first name is?
Azim.
Azim?
Yes.
And your wife's name?
Azusa.
Azusa? Azim and Azusa?
Jesus. Azusa. Azusa. Spanish pronunciation. Wow.
Yes. And your brother-in-law?
Roy.
Rowan?
Roy.
Roy. Roy.
And Chona.
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 Yes.
Well, welcome to you. Let's welcome them all. And back again for the second time is Annie in the back. Annie, it's good to see you again. Welcome. It's a miracle when someone comes. It's a great miracle when they come back a second time. That's amazing. Okay, so I've got to keep track of the program. Let's continue now with our 9 lessons in carols.
Isaiah foretells Christ's birth and kingdom. The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of deep darkness, a light has dawned. You have enlarged the nation and increased their joy. They rejoice before you as people rejoice at the harvest, as warriors rejoice when dividing the plunder. For as in the day of Midian's defeat, you have shattered the yoke that burdens them, the bar across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressor. Every warrior's boot used in battle and every garment rolled in blood will be destined for burning, will be fuel for the fire. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the greatness of his government and peace there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness from that time on and forever. The zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this.
Oh,
Jesse. From his roots a branch will bear fruit. The Spirit of the Lord will rest on him, the Spirit of wisdom and of understanding, the Spirit of counsel and of might, the Spirit of the knowledge and fear of the Lord. And he will delight in the fear of the Lord. He will not judge by what he sees with his eyes or decide by what he hears with his ears, but with righteousness he will judge the needy. With justice he will give decisions for the poor of the earth. He will strike the earth with the rod of his mouth. With the breath of his lips he will slay the wicked. Righteousness will be his belt, and faithfulness the sash around his waist. The wolf will live with the lamb. The leopard will lie down with the goat. The calf and the lion and the yearling together. And a little child will lead them. The cow will feed with the bear. Their young will lie down together. And the lion will eat straw like the ox. The infant will play near the cobra's den, and the young child will put his hand into the viper's nest. They will neither harm nor destroy on all my holy mountain, for the earth will be filled with the knowledge of the Lord as the waters covers the sea.
He tends his flock like a shepherd. He gathers the lambs in his arms and carries them close to his heart. He gently leads those that have done.
Thank you.
The angel Gabriel is sent to the Virgin Mary. In the sixth month, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a town in Galilee, to a virgin pledged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of David. The virgin's name was Mary. The angel went to her and said, "Greetings, you who are highly favored. The Lord is with you." Mary was greatly troubled at his words and wondered what kind of greeting this might be. But the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary. You have found favor with God. You will be with child and give birth to a son. And you are to give him the name Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever. His kingdom will never end." "How will this be?" Mary asked the angel, "since I am a virgin." The angel answered, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God. Even Elizabeth, your relative, is going to have a child in her old age, and she who was said to be barren is in her sixth month. For nothing is impossible with God. I am the Lord's servant," Mary answered. "May it be to me as you have said." Then the angel left her.
Considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, "Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins." All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet, "The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel," which means God with us. When Joseph woke up, he did what the angel of the Lord had commanded him and took Mary home as his wife. But he did not consummate their marriage until she gave birth to a son. And he gave him the name Jesus.
shepherds come to the manger. And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them. And they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all the people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger." Suddenly, a great company of the heavenly hosts appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven and on earth. Peace to those on whom his favor rests." When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby who was lying in the manger. When they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told them about this child. And all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. But Mary treasured up all these things and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things they had heard and seen, which were just as they had been told.
Judah,
but for out of you will come a ruler who will shepherd my people Israel. Then Herod called the Magi secretly and found out from them the exact time the star had appeared. He sent them to Bethlehem and said, "Go and search carefully for the child. As soon as you find him, report to me, so that I too may go and worship him." After they had heard the king, they went on their way, and the star they had seen when it rose went ahead of them until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they were overjoyed. On coming to the house, they saw the child with his mother Mary, and they bowed down and worshipped him. Then they opened their treasures and presented him with gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And having been warned in a dream not to go back to Herod, they returned to their country by another route.
So just as the wise men gave their gold, frankincense, and myrrh to the Savior, it's your turn now to give your gold and frankincense to the Savior. We're going to take up the offering as we sing. Please remain seated as the ushers will pass the offering baskets around to you.
The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify concerning that light, so that through him all might believe. He himself was not the light. He came only as a witness to the light. The true light that gives light to everyone was coming into the world. He was in the world, and though the world was made through him, the world did not recognize him. He came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him. Yet to all who did receive him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. Children born not of natural descent, nor of human decision or a husband's will, but born of God. The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only Son, who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. This is the word of the Lord.
Please remain standing as we sing this song. Send our kids out to joy time now, but I think Jacob's good here, right? Yeah, good. Lots of kids are away today. Before I get someone to pray for the sermon, just want to let you know that today, just a shorter sermon, is a part, the fourth part, in four sermons I've preached during the season of Advent, which is a penitential season, and I've been teaching you four spiritual disciplines. If you're going to navigate the world in which we live today, anybody think the world we live in today has gone crazy? Yeah, if you want to navigate the world in which you live today, you need spiritual disciplines. And during Lent, earlier on in the year, I taught you some spiritual disciplines. During Advent, I've taught you so far three spiritual disciplines. The first one was the spiritual discipline of Lectio Divina. That's a Latin word for divine reading. How you should actually read scripture. If you want to follow these up, you can see them on our YouTube channel, All Saints White Rock. How do you read scripture? Well, not like a newspaper, not like a novel. How do you actually read scripture? And we taught about that. Then the second week, I taught you about keeping the Sabbath. You know, it is a commandment. shouldn't commit adultery, should have no other gods before you, should honour your family, parents, should keep the Sabbath. How do Christians actually keep the Sabbath? How are you supposed to do that? I taught about that. Last week I taught you about, can anybody remember?
Money.
Money, right? You spend most of your life making money. How do you handle money from a financial perspective, from the Bible's perspective, how the Bible teaches you? How are you supposed to handle money? The world teaches us a very different message. If you're going to navigate the world in which you live today, as a Christian, you need to know how to handle money. Finally, today, we come to the final spiritual discipline. There are many more, but of the four I've chosen, I want to teach you about prayer. How do we actually pray? There's a million books on prayer, and yet very few people actually are committed to praying. So today we want to talk about the spiritual discipline of prayer. And on page 25, I haven't given you notes, just given you some lines. If you take notes, you're welcome to write. Now, having said that, let's begin. The tradition in this church is every time I preach a sermon, one of you leads us in a prayer for the sermon. So could I ask one of you to pray for us now as we consider the spiritual discipline of prayer?
Father, I thank you that we can gather here in this small community, but with significant friends and people around us, to hear your word through Peter in the quietness of this moment, this morning. In Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, John. In Paul's first letter to the church in Thessalonica, he instructs them to do something that seems almost impossible. 1 Thessalonians 5, 16, 17 and 18. Rejoice always, pray continually, and give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. Oh yeah, that's easy to say, Paul. Rejoice always, and in the Greek always means...
Always.
Always. Pray continually. And in the Greek, continually means
all the time.
Give thanks in all circumstances. And in the Greek, all means
all.
Right. These are very comprehensive terms. This is God's will for you. Yeah, right, Paul. You can write that because you're the great apostle. You want me to always be rejoicing. You want me to pray without ceasing, is the old King James translation. Pray without ceasing, pray continually, and in every circumstance you want me to give thanks. Okay, well, we're going to touch one of them today. Pray continuously. Pray without ceasing. You know, depending on your definition of prayer, that's impossible. If your definition of prayer is close your eyes, fold your hands and bow your head, you'd never be able to pray while you're driving your car. It'd be impossible to pray when you needed eyesight. Well, no, you're a bit more sophisticated than that. You even have an acronym for prayer and whatever it is. In your acronym of prayer, you know exactly the formula of how to pray. Good on you. Today, I want, with the help of some of my friends who have been dead for more than 500 years, I want to possibly expand your understanding of prayer. Excuse me. Now, there's three reasons why the church needs to be able, you, the church, why the church needs to be able to understand prayer. Number one, you need to understand the concept of prayer so that you can pray without ceasing. Number two, you need to understand the concept of prayer so that you know and learn how to navigate the world in which you live. If you walk around the world in which we live today with all its landmines, you could very easily blow off one of your legs spiritually and walk around crippled as a Christian, if you don't know how to navigate the world in which you live, you need prayer to do that. And thirdly, amongst many other reasons, you need to know how to pray and understand prayer if you want to grow in your intimacy with God. You want to be able to pray without ceasing, you want to navigate the world in which you live, and you want to grow in your intimacy with God. That's why I've entitled my sermon, The Discipline of Prayer. Prayer is a spiritual exercise, and it takes practice. It takes practice, and it takes practice to learn how to understand the concepts of prayer. So let me ask you the first question. What is prayer? It's your turn. If you're a visitor, we have conversational sermons. You actually get to respond because this is not entertainment. This is you and I on a journey before our God the Father, who is the audience. He's the audience. You're not the audience. He's the audience. Together we discover what God is teaching us. Your turn. How would you define prayer?
Conversation with God.
Is that it? Is that the only?
Praising and worshipping.
Praising and worshipping. Okay, what about this one? I'm going to stretch you a bit. Conversation with God. What about a conversation with Jesus? We still good?
Yes.
What about this one? I'm going to stretch you. Conversation with the Holy Spirit.
Yes. The whole Trinity.
The whole Trinity. Joel, you're really stretching us now. You mean prayer is talking not just to God, but to Jesus and the Holy Spirit? Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Okay. When you talk to Jesus, is that prayer?
Yes.
Are you sure?
Yes.
Are you absolutely sure?
Yes.
Okay. Can a Buddhist pray to Jesus?
Yes. He should.
Hey?
He should.
He should. Can a Muslim pray to Jesus? So, prayer is talking to Jesus, right? Prayer is talking to God, right? Prayer is talking to the Holy Spirit. So, let's explore this concept under what is prayer. Prayer is talking to Jesus. When you talk to Jesus, is it determined, prayer determined by where you are when you talk to Jesus?
No.
Are you telling me you can pray anywhere?
Yes.
Okay. When you talk to Jesus, is prayer determined by where Jesus is?
No. Jesus is everywhere.
Jesus is everywhere, so you can talk to him everywhere. Jesus lives, Christ in me, says Paul. Okay. Well, hang on a minute. Jesus, theologically, we're going to say this in the creed tonight, Jesus is seated at the right hand of the Father, right? And you're talking to him. That's right, right? Talking to Jesus, talking to God, right hand of the Father. Now, let me ask you this question, stretch you a little bit. If Jesus appeared here in physical form and you talked to him, would that be prayer?
Yes. Yeah. It's conversation.
It would be a conversation with whom?
Jesus.
Jesus is God. So you're having a conversation with God. Is that prayer?
Yes. Based on what we said earlier, it is.
If what you said earlier, it is. And you said that it doesn't matter where Jesus is. If you're talking to him, that's prayer. So if he was right here now and you talked to him, would that be a prayer? What about if you talked to Jesus while he was on the earth?
Yeah.
Boing. Here's where I'm going with this. What about if every time someone spoke to Jesus, that was considered prayer? Well, every time someone spoke to God, Jesus, that's considered prayer. And what if wherever Jesus was, at any time in history when they spoke to him, that was considered prayer. So if you go to the Gospels and you read of people talking to Jesus in human form, could I possibly stretch you far enough to think that could even be possibly a form of prayer? May not be a good prayer when people hated Jesus, would be like a cursing prayer, but every time someone spoke to Jesus, it's a form of prayer because they're talking to God. Just because he's invisible and you can't see him doesn't make it a prayer. And when he's visible, now it's not a prayer. I want you to think about that for a minute. Kathy?
I wonder if prayer can also be worship.
Prayer could be worship as well, right? Yeah. You see, what I'm trying to get you is there's a million books out there on how you should pray. But the old mystics and the old monks who spent a lot of time writing and thinking about this have suggested to us you could learn a lot about prayer if you understood that every time someone spoke to Jesus, as it's recorded in the gospel, that's a form of prayer. It would expand your understanding of prayer exponentially. Because not all prayers to Jesus would be godly prayers. Some people would be cursing Jesus. That's a form of talking to God. Some people would be asking, some would be worshipping. Everything that people did in front of Jesus was a communication to God. And maybe, before you stymie, let me finish my sermon, okay? Maybe our understanding of prayer traditionally has been limited by what we've read in other books rather than exploring the possibility that prayer is talking to God wherever Jesus is. If you wanted to do that, if you took that mindset and you started reading the Gospels and you underlined every time there was a conversation with someone that someone had with Jesus, and you considered for a moment that that could be a form of prayer, you'd be amazed how much you could learn about praying if you considered that. There are good prayers. There are bad prayers. There are inquiring prayers. There are cursing prayers. There are many, many types of prayers. In fact, the history of the church, we have used the prayers within the scripture and the conversations with Jesus as many parts of the liturgy in the church. The Benedictus, the Nunc Dimittis, these are all terms the church has been using for years. These are prayers in response to Jesus. Even when Jesus was a little baby at the temple, the people that responded to Jesus, remember there were people in the temple, you remember who they were?
Anna
and Simeon. Their words become the prayers of the church because they were talking about Jesus and to Jesus. Enough said, I am not going to teach you about prayer today. When I was at school, I think there were like four semesters on prayer. And they got us to read these big, thick books on prayer. Like, enough to say, I wonder if you could learn something about prayer if you were willing to consider the concept that every time someone spoke to Jesus, that's a form of prayer, much bigger than maybe our definition of prayer. So the first thing I want to say to you this morning is, number one, prayer is a conversation with God. We've got that. Second question is, who initiates prayer? Well, I got saved and I began to pray. Yeah, like, you know, I never used to pray to God, but then I got saved, I got interested, I found my spiritual roots and I began to pray. So when you pray, who do you think actually initiated the prayer conversation? Because you... Say that again, Joel.
The living God.
The living God, because you may be tempted to think that you're the one who initiates prayer. Well, I did go to the prayer meeting. We've been at this church every night for 6 months. every night, 7 nights of the week, from 7 o'clock onwards, coming and praying for you and for the community and for the $2 million that we need to raise to pay our loans off to buy this building. But have you ever considered the concept that it was God who actually started the conversation of prayer with you? If you read Hebrews 7:25, where the writer to the Hebrews is talking about who the great high priest was, and the great high priests in the Old Testament, they were human beings, men who died, but we have a great high priest, and his name is Jesus, and he takes on the title of high priest, Melchizedek. And we read now in Hebrews 7:23, now there have been many of those priests since death prevented them from continuing in office. So we've had lots of high priests in our history. But because Jesus lives forever, he has a permanent priesthood. Therefore, because he has a permanent priesthood, he's able to save completely those who come to God through him, because, say amen if you're listening, because he always lives to intercede for them. Jesus has always lived to intercede for you and for me. From the beginning of time, Jesus has been praying for you. There's a lot of people who don't even believe in him, don't even recognize him. You go do a search Jesus on the internet, on Google, good on you, Google. Some people think Jesus lived 2,000 years ago. Are you kidding me? There's more evidence for the existence of Jesus than there is for Plato and Socrates. And Plato and Socrates are the basis of all philosophical studies at school. He's been praying for you and for me from the beginning of time. He's been interceding for us. So, when the time came, you finally decided that you were going to pray to God, when you became a Christian or you started in your spiritual journey, you were simply responding to his prayers. He was the one who started the conversation. Before time began, he was praying for you by name. That's got to make you excited. Or as the late Eugene Peterson said, he wrote a book on prayer called Answering God. Every time you pray, you're simply answering God. He started the conversation. So, who initiates prayer? Point number two that I want to make this morning. Our prayer is a response to the prayers of Jesus for us. Our prayer is a response to the prayers for Jesus for us. So the next question you have to ask on prayer is, why should you pray? Your turn. Why do we pray?
Connection with God.
We
absolutely need
him to.
Someone else?
We were told to do it,
so in obedience. Why do we pray?
Because we absolutely need him.
To grow in our relationship with him.
I need his guidance.
Comfort.
Worship.
Okay, here's the dilemma. God's totally sovereign, right?
Yes.
Okay, I just ask you a fundamental question of the faith. I know you're a bit nervous because I'm taking you to places that is unfamiliar territory. I get that. But let's try this one again. God, the one that we worship, God the Father, Son, Holy Spirit, totally sovereign, right?
Yeah,
okay. You believe God's sovereign. If you didn't believe God's sovereign, then you better go find another religion. God is totally sovereign. He knows everything, right? So why should you pray? If he knows everything, he's only going to do his will, why would we pray? You think you're going to get God to do something he doesn't want to do, that he said he'd never do?
He wants a relationship with us.
That's why he wants us to talk to him.
He invites us to pray.
He wants us,
like, prayer
Right. To receive his love and to... Honor him, bless him. I'm saying this for the video, and know our position before him.
Well, I was thinking about that his will be done, and so prayer to be a form of submitting to his will.
Yeah. Okay, now you're getting to the next point here. That's very good. You were going to say worship. Yeah. Ed.
Yeah, God can do everything without our prayers, but he chooses to use us.
Right.
And to flow through us in community.
Yeah, he chooses to use us. I'll give you a couple of clues to this one. You know, there's no black and white. This is a discipline that the monks taught us. I want to encourage you to explore this discipline. Do you remember when Jesus was last day of his life here on earth before he was murdered, and he was praying with his disciples in a garden? You know what garden it was?
Gethsemane.
And after he prayed with the disciples, he went off a little bit further. Read this in Luke. And this is what Jesus prayed a prayer. So if you want a good idea of how to pray, you should watch Jesus when he prays. This is what he, Luke 22:41. Jesus withdrew about a stone's throw beyond the disciples where they were praying, knelt down and prayed, "Father, if you are willing, take this cup from me, yet not my will, but yours be done." What was Jesus doing when he was praying to God the Father then? Giving up his will. He was reminding God the Father that he would do whatever God the Father wanted him to do.
He was reminding about his conviction.
About the?
About his conviction.
About his conviction, yeah. He was willing to give up his will. Whatever. Not my will, but thine be done. Then, a little earlier on in the story, the disciples came to Jesus and they asked him many questions. And in my opinion, when the disciples asked Jesus questions, they were asking him prayer questions. They were asking him questions in prayer. One time they said to him, "Jesus, would you teach us how to pray? Because the only prayers we know are the ones we learned at rabbinical school when we were kids. All the Jewish prayers. Would you teach us how to pray?" And do you remember that story? What did he teach them to pray? This is then how you should pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom, your... You get the idea. If you look carefully at the conversations that people have had with Jesus, comes back to this old theme, doesn't it, Ed? Doing the will of God. Jesus taught his own disciples to pray, "Your will be done."
Even though Jesus is fully divine, he's sinless, he's also fully human. And so the surrender of his will is key.
Yeah, because he could, you know, the debate amongst the early church was, could he sin or was he not able to sin? Was he able to sin? Was he not able to sin? And my argument would be, yes, he was able to sin, because if he wasn't able to sin, he wouldn't be like us. So, but he never sinned. The point was that even Jesus taught his disciples to pray, "God, what's your will?" So Jesus modelled it and he taught it. So here's my third point. Overall, the whole point of praying is so that you can align your will with God's will. Yeah. We pray in order to align our will with God's will. You come here one night during our prayer vigil as we pray, we talk, we sing, we read scripture, and God begins to shape the way we pray. We might come with a particular attitude or a point that we want to make, and we tell God, and in our praying, because we're open, he changes
our will. So praying, apart from all the other things, is a way to align your will with His will so that you can pray His will. That's why I think it's fantastic when you say prayers that are based on Scripture. When you read, pray, extemporaneous Scripture prayers, you can't go wrong. Pray through the Psalms. Use them as your prayers because they were the prayers of the people for thousands of years. Pray through the Psalms. Just use that as a prayer. Well, very quickly, a couple more points. What's essential in prayer? Your turn. When you pray, what's absolutely essential in prayer?
Sincerity.
Belief?
Sincerity.
Sincerity?
Thanks.
Sorry, I didn't hear that. Say again, Annie.
Thanks.
Faith?
Giving thanks.
Gratitude. Thank you.
Gratitude.
Gratitude. Giving thanks. Sorry, Annie.
Trust.
Candidness.
Honesty.
Honesty. So if you look in the Scriptures and you take the Scriptures, conversations with Jesus, as a model guideline for prayer, you will see that there were many people who spoke to Jesus who weren't honest. They were telling lies. They weren't good prayers, but they were talking to Jesus. So, what's essential in prayer? Well, we get to the idea that prayer is talking to Jesus, and in every circumstance, whenever someone spoke to Jesus in the gospel, that was like a prayer. But I want to suggest to you that not all of those were good prayers. Not all of them should be models that you should follow how to pray. But it gives you an example of how people prayed. And that's today. People do the same thing, right? But you can pray in any way you want. You can pray in tongues. You can pray in English. You can pray in... Like Ed, when he whistles in multi-languages. He whistles in Russian. He whistles in Swedish. He's multilingual in his whistling. You can do whatever you like. But watch this. If the underlying purpose of prayer is to align our wills with His will, then what do you think is an important component of prayer?
Humility,
but even more than that, I want to get my will with His will.
Obedience.
Listening. Listening. If I want to get my will with His will, because usually when I come to God, I've got a big shopping list. And not only do I have a shopping list, I know all about medicine and I know exactly how I want God to heal this person with their thyroid and then the spleen and then do it with the heart and then the aorta. And we know exactly how to pray. It's sort of like we're giving God a medical lesson, except He invented the body, right? And sometimes we come to God and we tell Him exactly what we need done. And you and I need to learn how to align our wills with His will. And the only way that you can align your will with His will is to
surrender.
But you've got to listen. You know, surrender is part of it, but you can surrender your will and keep praying all the time and never listen. And in some prayer meetings I go to, it's so much noise and people have no time to listen to God. So this idea of actually listening to God, now this might throw you a bit, but silent prayer. Have you ever thought about that? Silent prayer. I've taught that, not here recently, because we've been sort of involved in raising money for the building and getting all that sorted out. But once that all gets sorted out, end of the year, Lord willing, then we'll go back to some of these things. Imagine being with a group of Christians who love Jesus, who all sit together in a circle in silence for an hour.
Now you may think, oh, never done that before, never thought about that. Let me tell you, I've done that many, many times. You'd be surprised how God speaks to those people. And then at the end of the hour, we say, what, did God say anything to anybody? And you won't believe this. Well, maybe you will now. Guess what? He said the same thing to everybody. He was actually speaking to us through each other because we were listening. Now, not all prayer, don't get me wrong. What I'm trying to do is give you a couple of snippets to extend and expand your understanding of how to pray. But praying involves listening and not just talking. It's the concept of silent prayer. So just imagine now, if you use the analogy that talking to Jesus in the Gospels is a form of prayer, imagine one night the disciples, it's a warm evening, a spring evening, and the disciples and Jesus are out in the wilderness somewhere sitting around the campfire at night, and the disciples are talking to Jesus. I call that a prayer meeting. Now, it's in physical, you can see the flames, you can hear the crickets because it's Mediterranean climate. You can smell the orange grove that's just on the other side of the Sea of Galilee because the wind blowing from the Sea of Galilee is blowing the scent of the orange grove. You can smell the orange blossoms. As you're sitting at the campfire is crackling. See, prayer involves imagination. And the disciples are sitting together having a conversation with Jesus. That's a prayer meeting. And they're talking to each other. And then they talk to Jesus and they say, Jesus, what do you think? And guess what? Then they quiet and they listen. And he talks to them. That's not a bad prayer meeting, right? Sitting with the master and talking to him and listening to him, learning from him. Now, of course, you would say, well, if I was there, I wouldn't be as stupid as those disciples. I knew who Jesus was, and I'd be listening carefully. Yeah, well, that's because you've got 2,000 years of history. But if you were there and I was there, we'd probably be doing the same thing. No, Jesus, no, you got that wrong. Let me tell you how this is going to work. Now, you're not going to Jerusalem. We're not letting you go to Jerusalem. They're going to kill you. Now, well, look, when you get up on the mountain, you give this speech to 5,000 people, this is what you need to say. Anyway, essential in prayer involves listening. Effective prayer, that's number four, involves listening. You've got to be able to listen to him so that you can align your will with him. Now, when should you pray? Your turn. How do you do that? How do you pray always? You have an ongoing conversation with him. Most people, even church people, they don't think about God until Sundays. Monday to Saturday, back in the real world, do your job, come back. I guess it's Sunday. I guess I should go to church. Christmas, forget it. I'm being with a family. I'm not going to church on Christmas. Are you kidding me? So even though a lot of Christians say you should pray all the time, guess what? We don't do it a lot. Call a prayer meeting, except in this church. You call a prayer meeting and a large number of people come to church. But the other pastors I speak to, I ask them, when you call a prayer meeting, how many people come? Hardly anybody. If you have a band and music and worship night, how many come? Oh, we fill the hall. But you call a prayer meeting, nobody comes. Paul says that you should pray continuously. How do you do that? That's just... It becomes an attitude and it's a discipline. It's like exercise. You practice. Look at this. Watch this. Remember that God is always listening to you. Matthew 6, 7 and 8. When you pray... Do not keep on babbling like the pagans. This is Jesus speaking to the disciples. For they think they will be heard because of their many words.
Do not be like them, for your Father knows what you need before you ask him. He already knows what you need. God knows what you're talking about. You don't actually even have to verbalize your words. You can just think them, and God already knows. You want to be able to learn how to speak out and speak in your mind all the time. During Lent, I taught you the discipline of practicing the presence of God with the help of our friend Brother Lawrence. That's what prayer becomes, the next step. You become aware of God's presence all the time, everywhere you are, even in the middle of your sin, and then you learn how to commune with him and you speak to him. You're having this two-way conversation with God at a level that goes beyond the physical. You're listening and you're responding. You're responding and you're listening. You know what the mystics used to call this? Spiritual breathing. Spiritual breathing. How often should you pray? As often as you breathe. So number five, prayer is like breathing. It's continuous. It takes practice. It's continuous. Let me finish with this last point. How should you pray? Well, I could write a book on that and make $1 million. I would never do that because I would never tell you how to pray. But there are lots of books on how you should pray. The disciples asked that question of Jesus, right? How should we pray? Do you think, well, he got them started. This is an alternative to the rote prayers that they learned at Jewish rabbinical school, and he taught them what we know as the Lord's Prayer. Technically, it shouldn't be called the Lord's Prayer. It should be called the Disciples' Prayer. This is the prayer that he gave them. This is what they should pray. Our Father in heaven, this is Matthew 6:9, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come, your will be done. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our debts, as we've forgiven the debts of others, and lead us not into temptation. People think, what, you mean God would lead me into temptation? No, what that means is, God, please protect me from myself, because I do so many stupid things. I need your help. Help me stop doing stupid things. Do you think after the disciples spent 3 years with Jesus, and he ascended into heaven, do you think that after that, every time they got together, the only prayer they said was this prayer?
No.
But Jesus taught them, you better recognize the holiness of God. You better recognize that he's personal. He's a father. Now, you may not have had a good father, but in the model of fatherhood, he was the perfect father. He's not just some theory out there. You can tell him that you want to do his will and only his will. And then you can tell him what your daily needs are. Ask him to help forgive you and stop you from being stupid, which we do quite easily. So here's the last thing I want to teach you about prayer. It's not how you pray that counts, but that you pray. Did you hear me, church? It's not how you pray that counts, but that you pray. I have people that I know, one particular good mate of mine, he won't come for lunch with me because he knows I have this policy. When you come with lunch for me, I pay, but you pray. You have to say grace. And he's so scared of praying out loud that he won't come for lunch. So next time I see him, I'm going to say, I'm paying and I'm praying. Then he'll come for lunch. But he's so scared to pray out loud. It doesn't matter how you pray, but that you pray. Ed.
Yeah, some people, they want to put on their best face.
Yeah.
But when we're honest about our deepest struggles, it's very healing.
Yes, yes.
A lot of people pretend.
You notice, really religious people, when you read the Gospels and the religious people talked to Jesus, if you understand that as a form of prayer,
That's like the high Anglicans praying when some of the, oh, Heavenly Father, we beseech thee in the righteousness of the Trinity. And sounds really good in public. But I tell you, my prayers, when I'm really desperate, by the time I get through the front door, I'm on my knees, sliding down the passageway and saying, if you don't help me, God, I'm done.
Help.
Yeah, exactly, Ed. Yeah.
Peter?
Yes, sir.
I have a friend who's a Muslim who's having problems with his wife. And I said, do you pray? So he said, pray all the time. I said, well, what do you pray for? I pray that God in all his power will take my wife and harm her very badly in some way. And I thought, I don't think that's right of me.
Yeah, but that's part of that theology, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, you know, the problem, God, is my wife. So can you change her? Change yourself. That's an idea. Maybe if we listened long enough to God, he'd be saying, listen, stupid, it's not your wife that's the problem. Oh, yeah, it's me. Took me about 10 years to work that out in our marriage, but slowly. So let me conclude. If you want to learn about... Oh, Kathy, yep.
Yeah.
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 Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. See, if you're willing to relinquish to God's will, you'll be reminded regularly how much you need him. So, if you want to learn about the discipline of prayer, and today we just touched a little bit on the concept of prayer, hopefully expanded that. Before you go out and buy another book on how to pray and prayer, how about you consider the Gospels as the ultimate source to teach you about prayer? Go read the Gospel, pen and paper in hand, and when you get to a section where there's a conversation with Jesus, see if you can learn something about prayer from that conversation. Maybe it might be a way to learn how not to pray. Maybe it might be a good way how to pray. Think about that. Read the Gospels, because every conversation with Jesus is a prayer. So, remember, prayer is a conversation with Jesus. Our prayers are only a response to his prayers that he began. We pray to align our wills with God. Effective prayer involves listening to God. And it's not how you pray that counts, but that you pray. He can hear every form of prayer when you talk to him. Now, we're not going to close in prayer. We're going to close with the confession and absolution. It's very good. Paul says, confess your sins one to another. Yeah, there's many ways to do that. We've got one way. But during this Advent penitential season, it's appropriate that you and I stand before God, or kneel or sit or whatever before God, and just remind ourselves that we need a Saviour. We've done things that have upset him, that we need to ask him for our forgiveness. And then although I read the absolution, pastor doesn't forgive your sin. God forgives your sin. But you need to know when you confess it, it is forgiven. He forgives your sin. So find a way that you want to just pray before God, and let's do this confession together on page 20, on page 26.
Dear friends in Christ, God is steadfast in love and infinite in mercy. He welcomes sinners and invites them to his table. Let us confess our sins, confident in God's forgiveness. Most merciful God,
we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done, and by what we have done undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Now look, we're going to finish the service with communion, and then we're going to stay afterwards. If you're available, we're going to have hot mince tarts and hot apple cider for everyone as part of the tradition of nine lessons and carols. It won't take a long time. We're just going to move some pews, bring in the food, and then you can stay around, have fellowship with us. But we're just going to finish with communion. But before we do that, we share the peace with each other. So could you please stand? And I say to you, the peace of the Lord be always with you. Now you share that peace with each other, make our visitors especially welcome. Okay, just a couple of quick announcements. This may not be culturally relevant anymore, but we are having church tonight at 7 o'clock, Christmas Eve service with candles, bring your family. And tomorrow, which is Christmas Day, we're doing a service. So if you want to be here, you're more than welcome. We think it's important on the birth of Jesus to celebrate his birthday. You will be celebrating his birthday in heaven for the rest of eternity. So that's available for you tonight as well. Immediately after the service, a couple of the guys are going to move some pews, if I can get your help. And we're going to go get our hot mince tarts, fruit mince tarts, and hot apple cider. We're just going to have a little bit of fellowship before you go home for lunch today and have some tarts. We want you to all stay for a snack. That would be really great. We're going to do that at the back of the church. One really important thing, we need to find accommodation for one of the ladies in our church. She's a new Christian. She's middle-aged and she has no family or pets, but we desperately need to find a place. And unfortunately, she has to leave her place at the end of the year. We just need a room or somewhere. If you know, or you could put the word out for us, for this lady that needs a room, would you please come and see me and tell me? Because we've got a week left to find a place for her to live and we don't have anywhere at the moment. So if you know anywhere, please let me know. We're desperate. Okay, now, this is an exciting thing. 12 months ago to this day, tomorrow, our musician, David Hunt, retired and his family left the church and we couldn't find a musician like to pay. And so Jenny stood it to be our church musician. So I'm going to take my husband hat off and I'm going to put my pastor hat on. You see, with my husband hat, a lot of times you come to me and have a conversation with me and then you'll continue the conversation with Jenny the next day because I never tell her what you tell me about. She has no idea what you're talking to her about. We in ministry, we keep it separate. And but as her hubby, this is fun to be her hubby and, you know, like, that the pastor goes home and lives with the church musician, but they're married, so that's good. But I want to put my pastor's hat on today. And, you know, Jenny has, for the last 12 months, without any remuneration, nothing, just done all the music preparation. She rehearses a lot because she, you know, was learning to play the piano. She chooses all the music. It's a lot of work. And then I have to rehearse with her. And she's tough. Like, you got to up to her standard. So anyway, today we had a conversation with the elders last week. And the elders thought, you know what? She's been doing this for 12 months. We should say thank you to Jenny. So, Janice.
I'm here. Oh, Jenny, come on.
Come stand up here so we can see you in the camera.
Good, I'm going to embarrass you even more.
You kept secrets from me.
So on behalf of our church and the elders, we just want to recognize we so appreciate you sharing your gift with us.
For the glory of God, right?
Amen.
And you guys sing so well. Thank you.
Oh, that's beautiful. Thank you so much for what you do.
Thank you. And you sing so well. I mean, that's the whole joy. And then when the choir was singing a couple, was it last week? You know, it was just a joy to have everyone singing together. It's wonderful to worship the Lord and tell his truths, retell the story.
Thank you for your work.
We want to recognize the gifts in the church, right? And as you have gifts and as we get to know you, we encourage you to exercise your gifts as well. That's a pastor's hat. Now put the hubby hat back on. Love you, honey. Thank you for all the work you've done. Okay, let's carry on and have our communion together. So this communion prayer that we're saying together is actually a whole bunch of scripture written down from over the centuries. And we've been saying these prayers since about the 4th century. Church has been saying this for a long time. People say, well, we can do it extemporaneously. We want to be led by the Holy Spirit. Well, you can do that too. The people who wrote this were led by the Holy Spirit when they wrote it. So we're just talking a difference of time frame, a couple of thousand years. So as Ed would often say to us, I've got some really, really good news for you. On page 28, I say to you, the Lord is here.
Yes.
So lift up your hearts and let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Father, you made the world and love your creation. You gave your Son Jesus Christ to be our Saviour. His dying and rising have set us free from sin and death. And so we gladly thank you with saints and angels praising you and saying together as a community, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. And we bless and praise you, loving Father, through Jesus Christ our Lord. And as we obey his command, send your Holy Spirit, that broken bread and wine outpoured may be for us the body and blood of your dear Son. On the night before he died, he had supper with his friends, and taking bread, he praised you. He broke the bread and gave it to them and said, take and eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And when supper was ended, he took the cup of wine. Again, he praised you and he gave it to them and said, drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. And so, Father, we remember all that Jesus did. In him, we plead with confidence his sacrifice made once for all upon the cross, bringing before you the bread of life and the cup of salvation. We proclaim his death and resurrection until he comes again in glory. And so here's the summary. Great is the mystery of our faith. As we say together, Christ and
Christ is risen.
And
Christ will come again.
You got it. That's the whole gospel right there. And now, talking about prayer, we're going to pray as our Saviour taught us. And I want to remind you that when we get to the bit that says, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven, that's saying I'm relinquishing my will to him. So let's pray as our Saviour taught us as we pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Now we do, just so that you know, we do this breaking of the bread after this part, just to emphasize the breaking, the fracture, so you understand what's involved. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are all one body because we share in one bread. So I say to you, draw near with faith. Receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he gave for you. and his blood which he shed for you, eat and drink in remembrance that he died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. At this Christmas time, when everyone's buying presents and giving presents, and you'll be with your family and you're giving presents and each of you giving gifts and stuff, I want to say to you that these, this here, can you see this? These are the gifts of God for the people of God.
Thank you. Almighty God, we thank you for filling us with the
body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ.
Through him we offer our souls and our bodies to be a living sacrifice.
Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen. Well, thank you for being here for the 9 lessons in carols. I pray that you heard the story and you sang the story. Just a quick reminder, immediately after the service, the boys will move some of the back pews and we'll set up. Please stay, have some fellowship with hot mince tarts and hot apple cider, non-alcoholic apple cider. So you're more than welcome to join us. Remember, tonight we're back here for a candlelight service, 7 p.m., just a short service, Christmas Eve service. And then tomorrow morning, 10 o'clock Christmas Day, we'll be here celebrating the birth of our Saviour. So as you go on your way this week, remember the discipline of prayer. It's not how you pray that counts, but that you pray. Maybe you might consider reading the Gospels this week, this month, and learn about how people spoke to Jesus. You might learn something about pray and then do it. So could I ask you to please stand for our final blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Let's remain standing to sing.
Joy to the world.
Go forth in the name of Christ.
Thanks be to God.